is about knowledge and narratives and demos. Partly because those are the themes of this conference, but also partly because I think those are three key words.
What's that? What's that? What's that?
I swallowed it someone's phone. So, because those are not only because those are the three key words of the conference, but also because I think those three words are super important for understanding how we see the world and how we can go forward in conserving biodiversity, not only here in Britain, but everywhere else as well. Now, as Joe said, I work at the Natural History Museum, and the Natural History Museum was designed as a cathedral to nature by Richard Bowe, who we now have the late Hope Quayle in the front, who is a narrative in herself. She's a narrative about hope that we can build for the natural world. The blue whale was the first species to be actively conserved on a global scale, and I think that she gives us a message that we actually can make a difference. We can make a difference. If we can make a difference to the blue whale, we can make a difference to all kinds of other things as well. Now, also as Joe said, I'm also the president of the Linnaean Society. Just so that nobody asks, I'm actually the third female president of the Linnaean Society. The first was Irene Manton, the second was Diana Edwards, and I'm the third. Now, Linnaeus may seem to be out of date and somebody who we can't think about, but actually he was really important in thinking about data, about biodiversity. Not only did he come up with a system in 1758 by which we name all plants and animals, he came up with it in 1753 for plants, but since I'm sure there's some zoologists who have this, we'll pay tribute to zoology. But he also had collections of his own, which form the basis of much of his knowledge. And since 2007, the Natural History Museum, the Linnaean Society's data, the data from the collections of the Linnaean Society, have been available openly and online. And this might seem to be something quite archaic and only of use to taxonomists. But actually, the names of most European organisms are Linnaean in origin. Many of the names of European organisms are Linnaean. So it's important to have these collections. This is a pressed fish. These collections available online so that we can actually compare things and figure out if we do have the same thing as was already described. So these collections are important for taxonomists, but I think they're also important for everyone. They're also a way of looking at the world, which shows us how Linnaeus looked at the world in a slightly different way than we look at it today. So in a way, that message from Linnaeus is that we look at the world, we are all looking at the world, but we're looking at it in slightly different ways. And each of those ways adds something to make it coherent. But what are data? What do we start out with? And I want to talk about that pathway from data to information to knowledge, and how narratives and networks are being part of that data pathway. Now, Linnaeus, in a way, defined evidence in his sixth edition of Systema Naturae, in which he said, in the introduction, before this edition, he included a category called paradoxa, which had things like dragons and stuff that nobody ever seen before. And he says, I've come to these conclusions by personally leading my pupils on wanderings through the tangled web of nature in order that I can spur others on to an examination and explanation of nature rather than the reiteration of perceived ideas. And he finishes this long and rather tedious paragraph by saying, I shall take exception to the tales of actors and the barking of dogs with equal measure. And what he's saying, essentially, is that what we need is evidence for what there is in the world. And that's what the National Biodiversity Network is all about. It's about evidence, and it's about the importance of evidence. So that was important to Linnaeus as well. Now, there's a lot of, I don't need to tell you that there are a lot of new research opportunities that come with open data, with open information. Lots of new research opportunities come. Things like looking into environmental change, citizen science, looking at measuring biodiversity loss, recognizing species, measuring hyperdiversity. All these things are things that come from having large amounts of data which are open and reusable by other people. And you can get some really big science with big natural history. This is just a snapshot of a few papers, none of which are mine, which have used big data from places like the Global Biodiversity Information Facility and the National Biodiversity Network, which of course contributes to GBIN, to come up with some very important things like looking at quantification of how many people in the world are exposed to the Zika virus. So things that make a real difference to people's lives come from those data points from natural history data. Now again, I don't need to tell this audience that aggregators of natural history data are
are super important in making this data globally available. And I haven't put up the National Biodiversity Network here because everyone here knows me about it. But GBIF, which is about free and open access to biodiversity data, and so you get these global aggregators, the national aggregators, but you also get institutional aggregators of data which feed into this open ecosystem. The data that's available are basically an ecosystem of data. And all of these different things feed into that in different ways. But what's very important about use of these data and using these data to create information which then can be used to create knowledge about the world in which we live is that these data need to be fair. Now, I know there was a workshop yesterday afternoon about fair data, so most of you probably know all about this, but it's never bad to repeat something important many times. And to be fair, data need to be findable, they need to be accessible, they need to be interoperable, and they need to be reusable. Now, those four things, oftentimes when one looks at one's own information, the information that one is characterizing oneself, it's a sum of those things, but not all of them. But to be really useful, data need to be fair. And in that way, we can go from local data to global impact, but also from this global aggregation of data back to local solutions for local problems. So by having fair data, we can work both ways up and down this information stream. So how do you make data fair? And again, most of you probably heard about this yesterday. To make things findable, you can have DOIs, or global unique identifiers, or barcodes, or something that makes data findable in digital space. So having it findable by someone saying, you know, it's on a thick covered down, five over, a fifth specimen down in the thing, and you know, you'll find it there and it has a blue pin. That's not findable. Findable needs to be findable by computers. To have them to be accessible, they need to have metadata that are understandable to both humans and to machines. And aggregators like the National Biodiversity Network and GBIF do those kinds of things. They make data findable. Putting data in through these aggregators makes them accessible to other people. Interoperable data means that you can train things, that data can be used, that different data can be used by the same systems. This means we have to have standards. So we have standards like GARCore and AutobahnCore, and the annoying thing of putting your data into a standard is that it's really annoying because one gets used to doing it one's own way. But in fact, to make those data fair, they need to be interoperable. And then reusable data is that these data have a clear usage licenses and provide accurate information to problems. Now, I'll come on to talk about licenses a little bit later, but that's essentially how you make data fair. It's actually not that difficult, really, but it's very, very important for their use later to create knowledge. Now, data can be fair in and of themselves, but actually what's really important is that they're connected, is that things can be connected in machine space in order to be pulled together in a way that is quick and easy and allows for their reuse in different kinds of ways. But it's also important to remember, and I probably don't need to tell this audience that, that each of these data points, so each data point, is actually a record of someone, somewhere, sometime. So all of those data relate back to people. And we mustn't ever forget that. That's a really important thing, is that all of this data isn't, it's not, data are not abstract. They all relate to someone doing something at some time. So what I want to do today is talk a little bit about some of the things that I've done. The things I've done are not necessarily rocket science, and they're not kind of necessarily cutting edge science, but they're ways in which I've been able to pull data together to create narratives, but also to create networks. And the power of networks in creating those narratives, which are essentially stories. Now, Joe and I were talking about how we were both at a conference called Biodiversity Next, I don't know, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, something. It seems like about 100 years ago now. But there was one of the keynote speakers was Max Gomera, who's head of the United Nations Environment Program. And he said the two things that we need the most in the world of conservation today are narratives. We need more stories. We need more storytelling. And we need more kindness. And I think he was right, is that we can only really communicate about nature through narratives, which are stories. Not made up stories, but real stories. And also a real kindness and tolerance of one another. diversity and inventions. It was called Mission to an Almost Unknown Planet. And I'm not entirely sure that we know a whole lot more about the physics program. But anyway, some colleagues and I got one of these grants to work on large genus of nightshades with which I've spent the last 2 years working. And there were a whole bunch of these projects on all kinds of different taxa. Now, one of the things that they were reacting to was the perceived lack of taxonomies. So there was, at the time, in the year 2004, 2005, there was a story out there, a narrative, that went, taxonomic expertise is disappearing. This is a total disaster. We will never be able to describe the Earth because there aren't enough taxonomies. But if you actually look at the data, at the number of taxonomies and the years, we have more taxonomies now than we ever have before. So what does that mean? I think this probably means that taxonomists now do much more than just taxonomy. That taxonomists do ecology, they do, and you'll see, this is, I'm a taxonomist, and I do a lot more than just describe species. We also tend to describe species in groups of people now, so we use networks a lot more. So this is a graph that's worth thinking about when we talk about deficiencies and impediments. John had a lot to do with thinking about the taxonomic impediment in the UK, but I think these data are interesting to think about what we mean by taxonomy, what we mean by taxonomists, because each of you is a taxonomist in your own way. So just that to think about. Now, one of the things that we did as part of this planetary diversity initiative is we made a kind of website which tells you all about everything you ever wanted to know about nightshades and possibly more. Underpinning all of that is a database which has interoperable standards. So it was done to the Darwin Core, and we contribute data not only to the institutional corridor, but also through GDIF directly, which means that places where we haven't seen specimens get to look at them. So that is a database underpinning all of that. And the other thing that underpinned that was an interoperable collaborative community platform in which everyone who was working on the project and anybody else who wanted to could contribute to this project through this collaborative platform. So what we tried to do is to build the biggest network that we possibly could of people who are interested in nightshades. And you'd be surprised how few people are interested in nightshades, actually. You know, everyone should be. But it's been a very interesting experiment in thinking about how you build a network to kind of increase knowledge about something. And of course, because we're academics, this led to lots and lots of papers, and lots of monographs, and lots of taxonomic work, and lots of understanding, better understanding of where things are distributed, and what species occur where. And we published, most of this has been published in open access venues, so that it's available to everyone, as well as being available over our portal. So open data, something that's findable, something that's reusable. The website, this website, is open licensed CC0, so we'll talk about that in a little bit, but it means that anyone who wants to can take a description off of there and reuse it for whatever they want. And that was my intention. Once I've described something, I'm quite happy for someone else to take it and use it for something else. So my colleagues said, what are you doing? You're making this, people will plagiarize you. Well, who cares? You know, the world, life is short. So we produce all these monographs, and that's all really great. But one of the really interesting things about having lots and lots of data about a particular group available is it allows you to see novelty in an easier way. Because when a lot of information is available, it allows you to see when something is different. And this is particularly helpful. We were discussing with Mike and John about whether or not we're hitting the species accumulation curve, whether we're slowing down describing the species of selenium. Actually, we're kind of not, and the real mother lode is in Brazil. And this is a new species from Brazil, which was described by a student whose name is there, but a bunch of us are on the paper describing this, which is that the flowers of this are this big, and they're huge. So this is something that shouldn't have escaped people's notice. It's extremely narrowly endemic, and it's a weird plant. It's called Selenium medusae because it's like Medusa's snake-like hair. It kind of goes all the ground in a weird sort of way. It's very cool. But so there's lots of new species that you find, and you don't know where to look, maybe, or what might be new unless you have information already there. Now, this is another little example of where to go. What data also allows you to do is allows you to create the information where you might find something that you haven't found it already. So we know that the world is not particularly, I mean, it is quite rather stored. You can lie down on your back in the Amazon and see air currents go off. So there's no part of the world which is not being touched by humans, really. But there are lots of places where people have not collected data. And so what we did when we studied Selenium in Peru is we took all of the records of endemic species of Solanaceae in Peru, and that's how many there were at the time we did this paper. And what we did is we modeled their distributions. So we used species distribution modeling to model the distributions of these endemic species. And then we plotted that, we did a comparison between that and the data points for the endemic species, and we saw where there were holes. And that's where we went to collect. So we decided the models say they should occur there. Let's go see if they're really there. And sometimes they were, and sometimes the entire mountain had been kind of taken to the ground as a gold mine. So there was nothing left there. So sometimes there's a reason why there's a data portal there. But other times, it means that people go on roads and go to easy places. And so we went to some pretty difficult places. And this then allowed us to look at distribution at both species. Species richness. We looked at both species richness and then species richness of endemics. And you can see that actually, contrary to what you might think, the real species richness in the country of Peru is in the deserts of the coast and not in the Amazon at all, for Selenium. It also allows you this combination of knowing where something is and species distribution modeling allows you to assess the conservation status of things more accurately. So this is a new species which we described in 2013, and we had collected it from here. And so what we did before describing it is we modeled where we maybe would find it again, and discovered that, well, we probably ought to find it up here in northern Peru. We went up there, and sure enough, there it was, all over the place. So if we described it just from our collections from here, actually our collections were just from here, we would have assessed it as endangered, critically endangered at the time of description, which is often what happens when new species or tropics are described. But actually, by modeling where it ought to occur and knowing we're trying to find it, it allowed us to kind of say what its real conservation status was. Now, that depends upon data. It doesn't want data about distribution, but when you combine data on distribution with data on relationships, on phylogenies, relationships, you can look at broader scale or global patterns than just finding new species. This is a study that was done with another graduate student in the United States. And what we did is we took a phylogeny, so a dichotomously branching tree of all of the Solanaceae, the whole family, the whole nightshade family, which was about 1,000 species. At the time when we published it, it was the biggest dated phylogeny that had been published to date at that date in 2013. But loads of people have done much more exciting stuff since. But we liked it when we were first. And then what we did is we divided every single species and said where it occurred. And we divided the world into essentially seven areas. And we divided it into seven because that was the most we could get without the models falling over, without the maths becoming too difficult. And then what we did is we looked at dispersal and exchange of the family through time. And what we came up with is this is kind of one picture which shows a lot of work. And what you can see is that nightshades are moving all over the place. They're going all over the place. So there's lots and lots of exchange through evolutionary time. And one of the most exciting things about this is that this study lent huge support to the date of 13 million years for the creation of the Panama Isthmus. There's been a debate going on in the literature about, no, the Panama Isthmus is 2 million years old. No, the Panama Isthmus is 13 million years old. So, and that is a big difference. That's a big difference, 10 million years in terms of evolution. And this lent a lot of weight to that 13 million year data. Combining those data about distribution and information about phylogeny, you can also look at where things are happening, at dynamics of evolution through time, and also in space. And that's where it really starts to get exciting. That's when you can create the story of what's happening with biodiversity, not only in space, but also through time. And this is, again, another PhD student that I shared with Andy Purvis, used to be at Imperial College, but is now at the Natural History Museum. And what she did is took that same phylogeny, and again, we looked at where things occurred, we looked and then we looked at diversification rates. So this would be kind of creation of new species. Now, what you might expect from the genus Solanum, which is the nightshades, is it's most diverse in South America. So most of the species of Solanum occur in South America. So you might expect, wouldn't you, that most of the diversification, the speciation, the creation of new species, generation of new species, was happening in South America. But in fact, that turns out not to be true. So one of the great things about having data and information, so data are those distribution points, information is information, is that the story can be very different to what you actually expected. So here we can see that red means high diversification rate, and that means that actually the highest diversification rate in this genus is in the old world. And that's the complete mirror of the species richness, which is completely counter to what we thought was happening at all. And so now we're exploring why. You know, but then it allows you to ask those big why questions. So here's species richness, which is the Andes in southeastern Brazil, the two volcanic areas in South America. But if you look at diversification rate, it's in Africa and in Australia. And it's dated to about Miocene, which is when the big eutrophication event went on in the center of Australia. So what this also tells us is something interesting about the world in which we live today, is the world that you wouldn't know it from being here, but the world in which we live today is becoming more arid in many parts of the world. So that may actually present evolutionary opportunity to some organisms. So change is not always bad. Change, climate change, can also be something that organisms take advantage of. So it's looking at that in a big global scale. But actually, looking at a bigger scale, going back down to South America, it's a bigger scale than some kind of smaller scale. So this is all of Angiosperms. So there was a paper that came out in 2016 that said there were 16,000 species of trees in the Amazon. And I thought, gosh, that's a really big number. I just filed it away. How do you do? You see papers. And so you file it away. But this is where we looked at that and verified taxonomically all of those data. But so it's all very good for people like me to kind of have published lots of other papers, you know, academics publish papers. But I just want to introduce you to a new kid on the block. And I think everybody should go and look at this. This is called bloodhound. And what this does is if you have an orchid, which is a sort of attribution thing that allows you to be machine searchable, orchid dead, it can be on Wikidata, but I think none of us are dead yet. And what this does is it attributes events to you. So here's my page, and I've identified 40,000 specimens, and I've collected 15,000 collections. So it allows you as an individual, as a person who's perhaps not an academic, to take credit for that work, which often isn't credited in academic circles. So what about virtual access? Virtual access is becoming more and more important. This is a quote talk about data availability. Now, because of the verification problem, people are imaging, museums are imaging specimens more and more. But actually, when you image specimens and they're available in all kinds of different ways, it's really difficult to use them. So aggregation, in the way that the National Biodiversity Network does this, is really important. And in plants, we do this through JSTOR, Global Plants, but this is behind a paywall. So this isn't available to everyone. And museums have often been perceived as being behind paywalls as well. But in a project called Synthesis, we made possible transnational access throughout Europe to non-partners. And this is a map of home institution by country and where people went. And we don't have to look at the numbers, but basically everybody went everywhere. And this is not just museum people, this is all kinds of people going and using museum collections. We have a new program at Synthesis called Virtual Access, which allows people to come together to ask for digital types of data. And anybody wants to talk to me about that again later. And I said I would talk about licenses, and licenses are super important. At the museum, we have zero, CC0 for data, and CC5 for images. And you can see that for the NBN, we need to have those two things as well. And our instinct is often to say non-commercial, but non-commercial means that people like Wikipedia or Wikidata can't use the information. So again, coming back to FAIR, data need to be open, they need to be fair, and they need to be licensed properly. And why is this important? And it's important because sustainability of not only our planet, but also of ourselves, is actually the big challenge in the 21st century. And this is the safe operating space for the planet, and these are the sustainable development goals. But But I think the most important one of these is the last one, which is goal number 17, which is that we need partnerships to create these goals to achieve sustainability. And partnerships mean people. And these are the people who've been involved in my network, and there are loads of them, they all do different kinds of stuff. But they're all connected. So if we want to create that narrative of our world, which has biodiversity in it, which where biodiversity is loved and respected, we need to think about creating those narratives that connect people through networks and opening up data in order to enable a view of the world, a model of the world that we live in. But that's not to say that all those data become anonymous. Is each of those data points, each observation, each record, is a really important piece of a bigger picture. This is Linnaeus made of data. So each one is a bigger picture, but connecting it is the most important thing of all. And connecting it means having those data open and accessible, but it also means people behind it to whom the data are attributed and who get credit for what they do. So I think by having data, we can create information. By creating information, we then create those stories which allow us to tell other people about how we are working together to conserve the planet. And I'd like to thank you for inviting me here today. And I'd also like to thank the Linnaeus Society and all these other people, and especially those people who've been kind enough to fund my work, with which I've had a great time over many years. Thank you.